lesbians seem to have set things up quite nicely. Welcome, welcome, Gunrod. My name is Beckett. I am a graduate of Border. That will be the esteemed visiting academy. Honor of Butter Gods. Yes, ma'am, not quite sure what everyone's going to. That will be my fellow performers. Come introduce yourselves. Virginia.
Call me Bird.
Fabulous.
Hello, it's Sam.
And Darby. Very nice. Thank you. Look at this attractive and obviously perceptive crowd. This is the perfect place for us to hone our craft. Let's finish getting ready.
Let's.
We're ready.
As I've said, on behalf of Water, the Wizarding Academy of Dramatic Arts, we present to you the tales of Beedle the Bard. We are a group of classically trained performers and puppeteers, constantly looking to perfect our artistry.
We certainly don't do it for the money.
Absolutely not. We do not accept payment. This is about art. Ladies and gentlemen, the Wizarding World is filled with tales of courage,
gallantry,
friendship,
hope,
and explosions! Oh, I don't know.
And some of the most famous of those tales come from a man who lived over 500 years ago.
His name was Beedle the Bard, and he had one of the most luxuriant beards.
Samuel, I hardly think that they care about his beard.
His luxuriant beard? Truth be told, I'd wager a Gringotts full of stacked gallants that there's not a child raised in the Wizarding World today who doesn't know about the tales of Beedle the Bard.
He heard that
hairy
heart.
Was it
in
a hopping pot?
Vanity, vanity! I'm quite finished! I would like to continue before my patience runs out.
Would you look at that, though?
That's bad.
It's like his patience running out.
Sorry.
Let's do what we came here to do.
What's that? What? Theater?
Who next sees?
Woo! What story are we telling?
Darling.
Ah, what story?
The Fountain of Fair Fortune.
Yay, that's favourite!
My fellow witches and wizards, everyone ready? We now present to you the Fountain of Fair Fortune. High on a hill, in an enchanted garden, enclosed by tall walls and protected by strong magic, flowed the Fountain of Fair Fortune. Once a year, hundreds of people travel from all over the kingdom to wait outside the garden wall. There, at sunrise, a single unfortunate would be given the chance to find their way to the fountain by sunset. Bathe in its waters and receive good luck and fair fortune forevermore. On the appointed day, three witches met on the outskirts of the crowd and told one another their sorrows as they waited for sunrise. The first, by name Asha, was sick of a malady no healer could cure. The second, by name Alfeta, had been robbed of her home, her gold, and her wand by an evil sorcerer. The third, by name Amata, had been deserted in love and thought her heart would never mend. The three women agreed that should the chance befall them, they would unite and try to reach the mountain together. The sky was rent in with the first ray of sun. Creeps from the dark field snaked the pressing mass. The creepers twisted themselves around the first attack. She grasped the wrist of the
second witch Alfleda, who seized tight upon the robes of the third witch Marta, and Marta became caught upon the armor of a dismal-looking knight. The creepers tugged the three witches through the wall, and the knight after them.
Asha and Alfleda were angry with the Marta, who had accidentally brought along the knight.
Certainly one can bathe in the fountain. It'll be hard enough to decide which of us it will be without adding another.
Now, Sir Douglas, as the knight was known, observed that these were witches, and having no magic, nor anything that seemed a non-magical man, he had no hope of beating three women to the fountain. He therefore declared his intention of withdrawing outside the wall again.
Faintheart, by your sword knighted, help us reach our goal.
And so the three witches and the forlorn knight ventured forth into the enchanted garden, where their herbs, fruit and flowers grew in abundance. Finally, they reached the foot of the hill on which the fountain stood. That, wrapped around the base of the hill, was a monstrous white worm, floated and blind. At their approach, he turned a foul face upon them and uttered the following words.
Pay me the proof of your pain.
Try, though they might, to move past the worm. The worm would not let them pass.
And Asha, despairing, began to weep.
Then the great worm placed his lips upon hers and drank the tears from her cheeks, satisfied the worm slithered aside and disappeared from view. The three witches and the nut began to climb the hill. Halfway up the steep slope, however, they came across words cut into the ground before them.
Pay me the fruit of your labours.
So Lutless took out his only coin and placed it upon the grassy hillside. But it rolled away and was lost. The three witches and the knight continued to climb, but though they walked for hours more, they advanced not a step. The summit came no nearer, and still the inscription lay in the earth before them. All were discouraged, except for Alfleda, who walked faster and harder than any of them.
Courage, friends, and do not yield!
She cried, wiping the sweat from her brow. As the drops fell glittering onto the earth, the inscription blocking their path vanished, and they found that they were able to move upward once more. With the removal of this second obstacle, they hurried toward the summit as fast as they could, until at last they glimpsed the fountain. Glittering like crystal in the mouth of flowers and trees. Before they could reach it, however, they came to a stream that ran round the hilltop, barring their way. In the depths of the clear water lay a smooth stone bearing the words,
pay me the treasure of your past.
Martin was the first to understand. Taking her wand, she drew from her mind all the memories, happy times she had spent with her vanished lover, and dropped them into the rushing waters. The stream swept them away, and the three witches and the knight were able to pass at last onto the summit of the hill. The fountain shimmered before them, set of its terms and flowers, rarer and more beautiful than any they had yet seen. The sky burned ruby, and it was time to decide which of them would be. Before they could make their decision, frail Asha fell to the ground. Exhausted by their struggle to the summit, she was close to death. Now Alfleda hastened to pick all those herbs she thought most helpful, and poured the potion into Asha's mouth. At once, Asha recovered from her sickness and was able to stand.
I am cured. I have no need of the fountain. Let Alfleda bathe.
But Alfleda protested.
And I can carry this disease, Asha, and now the plenty. Let a Marta bathe.
Sir Lucas bowed and gestured to Marta toward the fountain, but she shook her head. The stream had washed away all regret for her past lover.
Good sir, you must bathe as a reward for all your chivalry.
So the knight clanked forth in the last rays of the setting sun and bathed in the fountain of fair fortune.
Astonished that he was chosen, what a country, and giddy with his incredible luck. As the sun fell below the horizon, so left us emerged from the waters with the glory of the triumph upon him, and found him. was the kindest and most beautiful woman he had ever beheld. Flushed with success, he begged for her hand and her heart, and Amata, no less delighted, realized that she had found a man worthy of them.
The three witches and the knight set off down the hill together.
And all four led long and happy lives, which none of them ever knew or suspected. But the fountain's waters carried no enchantment at all.
Ladies and gentlemen, visiting while you feel the tales of courage,
gallantry,
friendship,
and love from Elgarve. And now I'd like to perform a short monologue from
that art's wonderful, Darby, but perhaps we should reserve your theatrical stylings for our next show. We must be off. Until next time,
thank you.